to how you, I'm sure that Delhi's weather is today unusually good in May, and perhaps I take this opportunity to welcome two very senior guests who are to be here with us for the subsequent sessions later today. Professor Ishwar Bhatt is the Vice Chancellor of the National Boys School, NUJS, Kolkata. And, you know, I met him, I think, a couple of years ago, and we discussed, and I found he was quite passionate about the research methodology, training, and legal research. And therefore, we discussed and exchanged some idea, and I thought that it would be very proper to have him for this workshop, especially he is going to present a discussion paper later today on philosophy, philosophical method in legal research. It's very important. And also we have Professor Shashikala Gurpur. Again, she does not need any introduction. You know, if I had to name five people in this country whom I honor and respect and I'm inspired, she is one of them. You know, I have never mentioned this to her, and I have heard her so many occasions, and particularly her last time when she was here for a similar workshop, her 2-hour lecture was phenomenal. Madam, you may not be knowing, this lecture has been recorded and being used as a source material. And you will not have the copy, I'll share the copy, and you would be surprised, on that day, you were in your full form. And it was such a brilliant analysis of doctrinal method in legal research. At least I have not heard anybody delivering with so passion, with so intensity, with tremendous exemplification. So I again thought it that let's invite her, and she has always been kind enough, though as a director of Symbiosis Law School in Pune, she is definitely a very busy person because I have seen her, but whenever any invitation is extended for this kind of thing, she always tries to find time, and she is with us. So thank you, ma'am, for being with us for this. I also take this opportunity to welcome my colleagues from the National Law University who are here. They are a great support, and of course the participants who are coming from all places. To give you a little background, as you know that NLU Delhi has set up a Center for Empirical Research, which is unique in its own way, and the idea is that it is high time that some shifting towards empirical research must be done consciously and by design. It should not be a very random happening or a very detached and isolated development in the scheme of the law school. So we started this legal research workshop movement since 2011, and since then every year at least 2 workshops are organized, and invariably the focus is, in one workshop we would focus on empirical methods mainly, and in another workshop we focus on doctrinal method, because empirical method is definitely important. But we continue to believe that because of the peculiar nature of the legal material, the doctrinal discourse is very important. Therefore, So since then, we have traveled a long journey, because we collaborated with Cornell Law School, and Theodore Eisenberg was the person who was our prime resource person. Some of you might have attended those workshops in 2012, 13, 14. And since then, we have evolved these workshops to make it quite tailor-made to the requirement of law researcher, in the sense that we realize that there are certain components in legal research which need to be focused, and in certain areas the competence development offers a lot of scope. To tell you something, in all these years I have come to certain conclusions, because I have learned a lot of things while interacting with you only. whatever issues which I understand, which are particular to empirical legal research, most of them I have picked up from my interaction with the participants from all over. Now I realize if you search the meaning of legal research in internet, mostly you are guided to the material which deal with searching the case law, citation,
finding the material.
This is not legal research. And legal research has become almost synonymous to what Manupatra offers or what these case law gateways offers to you. Means search to case law is legal research. This is the first point of crisis for me. I am quite disturbed. And mostly this meaning is largely derived. If you see, you search it today. If you search legal research, most of the time you are taken to accept the material which we have generated over a period of time and which is now on the internet. Otherwise, you are taken to how the material is searched, how the case law is searched. So case law search and at the most how the citation is done. How the citation is done, how the case is searched, I am not discounting the importance of these things. These are definitely very important things for a, but this is something not the legal research, in a sense. So, we have then started with this premise and understanding these limitations. We thought, let there be a full-fledged 5 days course, starting from how to identify a research problem, starting from that point, because I find how to make a problem researchable is a major issue. And it looks as if later in this session we are having a round table where we will discuss the critical areas in research. And there I think we'll have the occasion to scrutinize the status of research in this country and what are the issues which are, you know, challenging the entire research process. But what I gather is that the law school teaching and law school interaction or learning ambience is not at all geared towards legal research. We are not oriented to legal research, so therefore legal research is not happening. Legal research is not happening, it is not a random thing. It is by design. We are failing into legal research by design because we are not moving in that direction, therefore that destination is not reaching. We are not heading to the direction of legal research. You look at where do you locate legal research in your curriculum? It's not happening. This is something which is, so even though at LLM level we keep a full-fledged paper, but I can share what is happening to that core paper in most places. I don't know, sometimes you are teaching them in a very isolation without bringing that legal material that can be addressed, or how to develop those core skills. So doability of legal research is not happening because you need to do research to be able to learn research, because you cannot learn research unless you do the research. And interestingly, I am making a very difficult statement, but it is true. Research was non-starter mostly in our context. Whatever we have been doing, we were mistakenly thinking that we are doing research, we were doing something else. It is, so lot of opinionated, impressionistic writing was there. Mostly we have been writing in that fashion, but not essentially in terms of research which applies a scientific method. Research means the application of scientific method. Research means to be able to observe something, and based on your observation you are, you know,
using it into something.
So I'll discuss these issues in a later session, but in this primary session, in the opening remarks, I only say that this time this workshop is meant for serving two objectives. Because I capitalize on my previous experiences with these workshops, and I realize there are two very important areas where competency development is important. One is, what are important techniques? You know, 2 days ago I was in Manila attending a SNE conference, and an associate professor from Indonesia was making a presentation. And the issue was exactly the same, that why the quality of legal research
and also teaching is
declining. So they were struggling with this, what is. I happened to make a very small remark, which became a point of discussion entirely. I said, you don't have a toolkit. You don't have a toolkit to do the research. In your toolkit, in your kitty, you don't have techniques. You don't have specific techniques to deal with various issues of research. So somehow that skill development has not happened. So essentially, like for instance, a economics researcher or a sociology researcher or a statistician, they have a toolkit. A teacher and researcher have a toolkit. They use that toolkit when they have any. Unfortunately, the legal researcher could not develop that kind of toolkit. At the best, we know how a case is analyzed, how a case comment, and that is also a little vague. There is no principle. I said, the legal research is based on, all research are based on certain principles, and knowing those principles is of higher value. And the research methodology enables you to be scientific. Research methodology enables you to be objective. And achieving the objectivity in your writing is something very important. And that is the core function of research. Because, and in law, what is happening? We are gradually moving into subjectivism. Lot of impressionistic writing is happening. We feel, therefore, we are writing. So you are writing a lot of opinion-based things. I'm not saying that is bad. But sometimes that is not asked for. Sometimes you are asked for developing some objective writing. But we are so obsessed with our ideological leaning that we are unable to detach ourselves from our own ideology. And research methodology is a medium to make you detached from your own ideology so that you become a neutral researcher. And you become a medium to demonstrate the objective reality as it exists in the universe. Because nature is orderly distributed. So every phenomena which happens in the universe is informed by a certain principle. And searching those principles and sequences and norms is the function of research. These are the assumptions. So we have actually violated the basic assumption. And therefore, this workshop is a kind of modest contribution in this direction. And we have divided it into 5 days. The first day is soon after this opening remark and after your introduction. We would come to a round table. Unfortunately, Professor Bakshi was to be here. Yesterday he developed sciatica pain. And he wrote to him email, which I will share with you. I salute his passion. He was so keen to come to this conference that he has been discussing this workshop with me for the past 1 month. And he has sent me material and he asked me twice, thrice what I am going to do in this. So, but he developed some sciatica pain and he has to undergo some procedure, some surgery, not surgery but some test. And so he said he must share this thing, that why I am unable to come, because he is a very, very, you know, a special person for us. Similarly, Professor Jaiswal, he has to rush to Nagpur for some meeting, and the selection committee is going on, otherwise he was to. But incidentally, we have huge human resource available. And so in this session, we will discuss some critical issues in legal research in India. This session is basically the first opportunity to interact with each other and to list down, and in this session I want your participation also. But where do you think that the legal research is going wrong? Where do you think the legal research is becoming deficient? Where do you think that the legal research is not becoming a priority? all those kinds of things in order to just, you know, grab this space and to identify the core issues for the analysis. And thereafter, two learned experts would have their respective sessions today day. So today day is kind of basically the development of platform. From next day onwards, we will be getting into specifics. And these sessions would involve some exercises also. You need to involve. And I have invited from Daksh. Harish is a very accomplished person. Now Daksh is doing some good work, those who are following the Daksh research. And they are doing some primary empirical legal research. And Harish was so busy, but I insisted that you are making a lot of research. You please come and share your experience of doing this methodological research. And then empirical research we'll introduce later tomorrow. And all the steps in a systematic manner would be that day three, we are introducing impact assessment methodology. Now again, Meeta Goyal is coming. She is an expert into evaluation studies, because we are thinking that the law impact assessment is something which is not happening in this country. Law impact assessment. Now, so suppose a law has to be assessed and evaluated, what kind of methodology can be adopted? So in this session, my expectation is that we would together try to learn the whole process of learning the techniques of impact evaluation. And I don't know if you are pursuing, many organizations have now completely devoted to themselves for AME methodology, monitoring and evaluation studies. Even Niti Aayog is doing good work, Productivity Council is doing good work, and even abroad. So AME approach, now that's what I am saying, law is a very, very interesting interdisciplinary subject. We are somehow not borrowing from management or sociology in terms of learning these skills and methodology, which would ultimately and in turn help us in exploring our own material. But I have some reservation on one thing, that we cannot expect some external expert to be invited in to do unless the core legal researchers would themselves train into these methodology, because they know the dynamics and undercurrents of the subject material. Now, an external management person won't be able to do research for you. He can give you some understanding of methodology. But it is ultimately you who will have to equip yourself to do this. Now, later on that day, we will introduce the data processing and qualitative techniques. And SPSS, we are doing one day workshop on SPSS on day 4. Please do not miss. And before that, I'll do a lot of orientation, like how to feed the data, how to code the data. All these things I would be dealing with, because Rahul Mangan is again expert who would be coming to mainly deal with the application of SPSS. Now, SPSS is something which is now very, very important for us to know, because whenever we are dealing with a research which involves the data collection from various sources. Now, how to handle that data? I think you will be shown that this easy software can result into a very easy production of tables, marginals, and good amount of information for your research to be applied and used. So the entire day, 25th, is devoted to the SPSS training, the whole day workshop. And before that, half day. So 1.5 day I am using, because I want, see, whatever amount of speaking I do, you will not be able to carry anything take home unless I give you some specific skill in terms of how to. So how of the research is the focus, how. So I don't mind if you learn even the 25% of all what is delivered, but at least there would be some take home. And I will make sure that after this workshop, we will count the skills that we learn. Please make sure that you understand what are the skills which you learn after the workshop. So SPSS, I am looking at, some of you must be knowing how to use, but then this is still very important. Now friends, I also came across, this is perhaps for the first time in the country, which is happening, I don't know, but to my mind it is first time happening. Last time, Sandhya, you were there in the doctrinal legal research workshop that we organized. I am also a great fan of doctrinal research. It's not that, but problem is, even doctrinal research is a grossly misunderstood technique in India. What you think doctrinal research is not in fact doctrinal research. Let us destroy our own notions. Let us demolish. You have to demolish certain, you have to sacrifice your, you know, chains. Unko aap us nadi mein unko samarpit kar do, usko chhod do. You have to withdraw your chains. You know, whenever you say that I have used the doctrinal methodology, you are trying to make it a convenient ploy in terms of saving yourself from the scrutiny of a tough madam will tell you later. Doctrinal research is very difficult to be mastered. That is very difficult. But this is something very essential for a legal researchers to. And that is what I am saying. Neither we are doing doctrinal research, nor we are doing empirical research. So after all, what are we doing? This is the mystery that is to be unraveled. We need to find what are we doing. We have to be little, you know, merciless to against ourselves. We have to criticize ourselves actually. We are doing a kind of introspection. This workshop is introspection. That what exactly are we doing? Is it that, does it qualify the requirement of a rigorous model of research, whether doctrinal or empirical? Does it fulfill the assumption of empirical or doctrinal research? So it is very important, and I don't have hopes from everybody. Out of this 30-40, if 4 or 5 come to the wavelength on which we are thinking, the purpose would have served. And you can carry this message back to your places, and you can yourself, like many people I know who have been
attending and coming, they have themselves now transformed into,
like Sandhya has been attending workshop now, she is inviting me because she is organizing one. So this is how it happens. It's a contagious effect. Anyway, so at last, yeah, I am telling you, so what happened in that workshop, we elaborately discussed 3 days on totally the doctrinal workshop, and we discussed different techniques of doctrinal workshop. Now, techniques level, you don't know what are the, like I say, what is the discourse analysis? What is the meta-analysis? What is the grounded theory? All these things are the part. What is the theme? What is the code? All these things are part and parcel of the language of doctrinal methodology. Now, no legal research is characterized by this terminology because of the lack of competence. And then I also realized that Atlas TI is the software which can be used in qualitative research. It can help in analyzing the text. So a lot of textual analysis and documentation, document examination is possible. Now I am making an experiment, or I am innovating, that this is my assumption, that Atlas TI can be a very important and effective tool in analyzing the legal material. And it can help you to tabulate the textual material. Tabulating the textual material is a great
satisfaction.
So suppose you are analyzing 20-50 cases, you can apply Atlas TI. It can create codes, categories, themes. It can beautifully done. So we have already introduced, and we have purchased this software in NLU Delhi. So again, you are going to be the first lot of people who would be undergoing Atlas TI. Has anybody done? I am sure nobody has done Atlas TI. So this is what, there are many firsts which would be happening in this workshop. And I am also experimenting, because I am of the firm belief that a day will come, some of you will publish the paper application of Atlas TI in legal research. There is no such paper. Nobody has done it. So I think this is 21st century. You are all very young people. And it is very important for you to innovate with these technologies. I know it is लिटिल स्कैरी फॉर यू टू कम आउट ऑफ योर कंफर्ट जोन. आप कहोगे मतलब हाथ से वी विल एबल टू डू आवर रिसर्च एंड केसेस एंड रिप्रोडक्शन ऑफ द मटेरियल. लॉट ऑफ थिंग्स आर हैपनिंग बिकॉज़ प्लेजरिज्म इज बिकमिंग अ ह्यूज इशू. दैट सॉफ्टवेयर हैज आल्सो कम. नाउ यू कैन नॉट रिप्रोड्यूस द मटेरियल. सो आई थिंक इट इज इन दिस कॉन्टेक्स्ट द वन डे वर्कशॉप ऑन एटलस टीआई इज गोइंग टू बी वेरी वेरी यूजफुल. एंड Sudeshna Ghosh, you know, I'll introduce this person. I'm very impressed with this person. And you also have to be impressed. Why I'm saying, I have not met someone like her. You know, I invited her, I spoke her with him a couple of days ago. Hello. That you have to, you please come. She is an expert. She got so thrilled. She's coming for past 7 days daily to the university. To understand what is to be done, and she is doing a lot of stuff. For last 7 days she is working on FSTI in my library.
So I am very happy. Is she there? She's not there.
So I'm really looking forward to this particular session. This is going to be a very important thing. And now I have this is the plan. Now in the process, I have two expectations from you. One is, you please speak out, be participating, and any time you can raise. This is not a lecture session. You feel free in terms of participating in every session, make everything. And at any stage, if any suggestion occur to you, please note it down. Just note it down and give it to me. And immediately, because though I have positioned all session, but I can take care of any suggestion or any particular area where you want emphasis. But this is how we do. Well, it's not that we are so committed that we have written something, so we will not do anything else on that. It's a very flexible and very, you know, easy way. So you have to be into it. And I'm sharing something that though these workshop and this is a very intensive program, but I have also made some arrangement for you so that you have some free time. Meanwhile, because of in each session you are saying it would be interactive, then you are working on your computer doing the things, and I thought you deserve more than that. So I have organized one evening, a cultural evening, a music concert for you. Because data, statistics, music, for me, all these things, you know, they go so well together. So on 25th, please keep your evening reserved with us. You'll have a very good musical evening, followed by dinner. You like it, or it's fine? You're not responding. I thought there would be some kind of reaction. Because in 5 days you are here, so something is to be offered. You can also take part. You know, we are very straight people actually. We thought there would be a proper... No, this is very easy going. Idea is that let us make good use of our time. So 25th evening, everybody has to compulsively be here. And you can participate also. You can sing, you can play, you can whatever. I mean, some participation. But is it okay? This is very important. Because I am very fond of retro music. So actually, this workshop is a kind of pretext. Actually, I wanted that musical concert to be organized.
it's a really pleasure having you.
Because I am really quite encouraged with the response and the correspondence that I have seen. Some of you, it's very interesting. And I am sure that this is going to be a very, very important contribution in terms of knowing the nitty-gritty of... I'm sure I have not answered everything because we have enough time further, and we'll be dealing with all the issues. And at this moment, I want a round of introduction. And though in your introduction, you will say your name and your place. But if you want to say anything else in addition to that, in terms of your area of interest or why are you here, so little ice breaking is needed. Is it okay? So meanwhile he speaks, let everybody think what you are going to speak, you know, apart from your name and place. Right. So we'll start from you. You are sitting first, so I have no choice but to say that we'll start from.
Myself, Ashish, and I'm from UPS Dehradun. Basically, I came for this workshop because I'm very novice, to be frank, very novice at legal research. I don't know how to do the legal research. And for as of now, I have recently enrolled in my PhD. That's why I came for this.
My name is Ashish. I'm also teaching at UPS. So that was the first time when I was using the things which I had learned during the FPSS session here, the ones we were discussing. And I had also learned it from Computer Center of the UP. But still, that thing helped me learn how to apply FPSS. And then I had also worked on certain research projects, like one was initiated by IDRC Canada. And I was doing it with Advocate Kirti Singh, and we had almost 80 plus questions. And these questions had other parts. Some questions were qualitative, like what are the reasons for separation. It was on separation and divorce among Indian women. And we had 410 women interviewed. So it was really difficult to, you know, from qualitative to put it in quantitative and then prepare the data and then analyze it. So it was really great experience, and along with that I had done other projects also. So I want to learn more, especially I'll be interested in Atlas TI. Thank you.
Good morning,
sir.
I'm Namita Singh Malik. I'm from Sharda University, assistant professor. So I am here obviously to learn, and one thing which I very humbly and all the time I do admit that actually I've been teaching few subjects. Like I teach criminal law, I teach family laws, and I'm teaching research methodology also. I don't know how much justice I'm doing to my job, because here I would be able to analyze myself that how well I'm able to teach or what exactly, whether I'm on the right parameter, on the right track or not. But surely, I'm sure that the skills which we will be able to, you know, have after this workshop is definitely going to benefit me and as well as the students. And so, especially with the way you make everything so light and so, that's really very nice. So, thank you so much.
Hello, good morning all. I'm Shanti from Sharda University. I'm actually doing my PhD in the area of workforce diversity, and actually I'm looking at this workshop from a multidisciplinary perspective. I'm looking at how I could incorporate the research in law also into, I mean, basically my research area is in the management, but because I've done my law and I teach law to legal aspects to the business students, labor laws, it's kind of a multidisciplinary approach that I want to give it to my PhD. So I look from some inputs from this particular workshop where my legal part, saying the concept of workforce diversity, I would like to have some inputs.
Hello everybody, myself Neha Kapoor, and I am teaching at the Rhodes University. I'm also a PhD scholar, and I'm researching in the area of banking laws. My aim for the workshop is to analyze the topic from the methods that can be applied to it, as to both the doctrinal as well as the empirical methods. Thank you.
Hello everybody, I'm Rangin Pallad Tripathi. I'm a faculty of law at National Law University, Odisha. The reason I have wanted to attend this workshop is that I am interested in the research concerning judicial reforms mostly. My PhD was in the area of judicial performance evaluation. Currently also I am implementing, I am involved in a department research project on performance appraisal system of subordinate judiciary, which is more of a qualitative research, and my PhD was more of a quantitative research. I want to expand and be able to work more, do more meaningful research in the area of judicial reforms. So I wish that's the reason I'm interested in it.
Thank you. Good morning, everybody. I am Dinesh Kulte, Assistant Professor at Imperial College of Ahmedabad. I am doing my PhD. So that this workshop will assist me to complete my PhD and to learn more things from this workshop. I will join.
Good morning, everyone. I am Rashmi. I am assistant professor at Padmaskali University. I wish to join this particular workshop because I have the teaching experience, but unfortunately, I have no research experience. So I want to get the idea about how the research basically have been done. So it is for this, I want to join.
Very good morning to all who are present here. I am Randeshna from IMTM School of Law, Kakaduma, and I am here. I want to learn about the research methods because I am not aware about it, and it's a very interesting topic. That's why I am here. Thank you.
Good morning, everybody. My name is Ami Kaur Sethi. I am an assistant professor at IMTM School of Law, affiliated to DJSIB University, New Delhi. Basically, I have joined this workshop. I have three objectives behind it. First objective is to learn about the nuances of legal research. Second is to, I want to prepare synopsis for my PhD. I want to pursue it. Third is, being a teacher of law, I should be aware of, I should get hold of the basics of legal research. So that I would be able to, this way I would be able to teach my students the legal research methodology in a very refined manner. Thank you so much.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Drishtirupa Padgiri and I'm from Shankardev University, Naugaon, Assam. And I'm looking forward to doing my PhD on the Borderland Territorial Autonomous Districts. There is a lot of conflict-induced displacement since the late 80s. And I'm looking forward to doing my research on that area, and hence I'm hoping I'll learn a lot in this session. Thank you.
Good morning, I'm Suman, and I just joined my PhD, and I'm here for this workshop because I really wanted to learn. This is the beginning stage of my PhD, and I don't know anything about research methodology, so it was a good opportunity. It's an earlier stage to learn things.
Good morning, everybody. I'm Dr. Shobha Bhagwat from Jawaharlal Lake City University, Bhopal, and I have done my PhD in pre-bargaining. And I hope, seeing the gathering and having so many four participants, the young people here, and I'm thinking that I'm going to learn a lot of things from you also, apart from the session. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Jaspreet Kaur, research scholar from Punjab University. So I've just joined PhD. I'm in the middle of my synopsis. And like Sir said, I'm not aware about anything about research methodology, and so that's why I'm here to learn more.
Yeah. Myself, Shakti Kumar Agrawal. I teach administrative law in the University of Delhi. Legal research methodology is always a very important subject. I came here with the idea to learn new things in research methodology. And on the very first day and in the very first session, I came to know about the software. And the first thing I would like to do is to make this software accessible with the assistive software so that visually impaired legal researchers should be able to use the same.
Good morning, everyone. I am Ms. Vatkha, trainer coacher and assistant professor at Vivekananda Institute of Professional Studies, IP University. And honestly, I've not really had an exposure of legal methodology. So, of course, as sir has very rightly said, in law schools, we are more into Manu Patra or SSC, or doing the case study, or just a commentary on any subject. So we have not really had an exposure of what actually a legal research is. And I see this as a golden opportunity to actually find answers to how to go about research and the methods involved. That's why I'm here. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. Myself is Dr. Bindu Sangra from Jammu University. As I said, I am doctor already. I have done PhD, but it was doctrinal. So this workshop is more about empirical and all that. So that is the biggest reason.
You know, I forgot to mention something, that many of us are doctorate also. So sometimes doctorate happens, research doesn't happen. Not necessarily all PhD leads to research. We are thinking a situation where PhD should also result into research. No, not you. Please don't take it. But because it is something happened, we asked the student here who want to join PhD here. So I said, are you here to do PhD or are you here to do research? He said, what is the difference? All PhD may not result into research. So sometimes, so even if we are PhD, fine, there is still a lot of scope. Otherwise, this PhD become a kind of certification that we know. But I think the research is too vast to be able to command it. Like, I find, like the biggest insecurity which I develop, more I read, more I become insecure. Because there is a huge scope to understand techniques and the way the things are moving. So I'm happy that you raised this issue.
Dr. Seema Nargothra, professor from Department of Law, University of Jammu. I am guiding the PhD research scholars also at present, and I have attended a lot of these ICSR research methodology courses and research methodology courses from other universities also. And they always move with a presumption that we know these techniques. So they are all, most of them are the social scientists there, and people from raw background, the number is very low. And there is always a presumption that everybody knows SPSS and other methods, because they have already learned these methods in their MPhil courses or PhD. But law teachers or law researchers, they are not conversant with these methods. And in law, we simply restrict ourselves to the hypothetical deductive method, and rather there is always a hesitation to venture into these methods, because we are not used to these methods, we have not been trained to use these methods. So I think as I was going through Professor Vajpayee's this pamphlet, which is being circulated to us, that the accuracy, we are not able to achieve that accuracy that is needed in law, and we are more into that opinionated and impressionistic outcomes that we are producing. So it would be, I think, it is very, very important for us to learn these techniques as well as to apply these techniques so as to achieve accuracy in legal research. I think that will be the most important aspect for us to ponder over these methods and to learn these techniques so that we are able to use them with proficiency in our
legal research.
Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. I am Pooja Kumari. I am working as an assistant professor at CULSAPES. I have completed my LLM last year from NLU Jodhpur. So it's my first teaching experience and the first teaching assignment, or the first job, you can say. And as sir rightly said, I won't deny the fact that maybe at LLB level or LLM level, whatever I have read about research methodology, I just don't know how to apply it. I have read it in isolation and I have no idea how to go forward with my PhD with that respect. I even don't know what is the basic difference between research methods or research methodology, which we have been taught in the college, but then it was just in the sense of theory. But the practical application is hardly, it has been taught to us. So I will be starting with my PhD, so I think it will be a very fruitful experience for me to attend this workshop so that I could at least start with my PhD and think of an area, think of a topic, and go forward with it. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Charu, assistant professor at UPS Dehradun. I think everyone has said so much, I'm not left with anything else. But yes, I have two reasons for attending this workshop. One is that I'm also pursuing my PhD, putting it in the directory, legal research from PhD. And second is that, I believe class teaching is also a performance, also required method. So every subject needs some kind of method, or every topic in a subject also needs a method. So understanding research methodology is definitely going to help me in delivering the lecture in the right method. Thank you.
we have some friends sitting here. Good
morning. This is Shom Shivastav. I'm assistant professor at University of Petaram and I just studied Dehradun. I'm teaching criminal law right now, so this workshop focuses much on criminal law as well as research methods. And also I'm pursuing my PhD, so I think I'm hopeful that this workshop will benefit me a lot in developing my, in adding to my research methods and also my improve my teaching methods as well. Thank you.
Good morning everyone. I'm Anubhav. Again, assistant professor at UPS. And it's a blue ribbon for me to be a part of this workshop. My research area is sentencing. I'm working on sentencing in my dissertation also. And I have worked on sentencing in PhD also. I'm working on sentencing guidelines. So I think research is not that easy to understand also. As sir has said, and I believe that it's a continuous process to learn the research. And unless and until we don't practice it enough in a full-fledged manner, in a particular manner, it's not that easy to learn research. So I'm here and I'm very hopeful that I'm going to learn things. Okay.
My name is Shiva Kendra, and a lot of familiar faces here, including two of my teachers also, both from NLI Bhopal. So I think it started with the fact that sir visited us for a methodology workshop in January this year itself. And since I have a lot of things to learn from everybody, including all the speakers, since I'm also going for my PhD coursework with NALSA coming June. So I think this will be a precursor to my learning there, and I hope to learn a lot as much as I can.
Good morning everybody. This is Dr. Sameeksha Kodara. I'm working as an assistant professor at the Department of Law, Central University of Haryana, Mahendragarh. And I have attended a lot many workshops in the past also in MLA.
Every workshop.
Yeah. And I have learned a lot from those workshops, and that is why I'm here again. And as Pankaj sir has rightly said that I did my PhD, but this time we are introducing research courses at Department of Law, and fortunately I'll be guiding some of the research scholars. So I'm looking forward to have, to collaborate with those research scholars for a legal research, not only PhD. Thank you.
Great.
Good morning, my name is Raghav Mehdi Ratna. I believe I'm the youngest here and I'm also a chance attendee. I'm a student of NU Patiala and today is my first day as an intern at the Center for Criminology and Victimology. I'm fortunate and glad that I'm getting to attend this workshop at such a young age, because I believe at this age is when my scope for learning is the highest. So I'm fortunate to be here and I'm looking forward to the workshop.
He is intern with the center, they just joined. Hello,
yes.
Hello to you.
Good morning all of you. My name is Pavan Sharma. I did my PhD from IIIT Allahabad and currently I am working with MIT University Noida as an assistant professor. Recently I got my PhD awarded, so I am not in practice of using doctor as a prefix with my name. My PhD was more of empirical, where I did a research on patent citation. Like we all know what is patent and we all know what is citation. So I applied the method of economics using a lot of regression models and some techniques of engineering to find out the importance of patent citation and to find out the value of those patents which are not used for any product. So I have very high hopes from this workshop, because I have applied for a postdoctoral in Turin University and I'll be going for a postdoctoral from July. So I think there are a few things which I'm lacking regarding the empirical research, which I will be able to learn in this workshop. Thank you very much.
Hi, good morning. This is P. Srinivas. I'm working as an assistant professor at MS Law College, which is an affiliate of Marwari University.
Which college?
MSS, Marwari Shikshan
University. Where is it?
It's in Hyderabad.
In Hyderabad? Hyderabad.
And I have come here to learn new concepts, more particularly on to the empirical research, which is interdisciplinary and gives us more to analyze more legal concepts and the same to impart to the new upcoming students.
Good morning, all of you. My name is Lakshita Hudwal. I am a working as assistant professor in the University of Rajasthan. Well, my aim to attend this particular workshop. Me and my colleague, we are from University of Rajasthan. I have attended 2-3 workshops or the orientation program and professionals. Why I'm saying so? Because on that workshop, they discuss about the legal research, but I want to associate because my subject is law and I want to learn the modern and the very much interesting technique whenever I do my PhD, because I'm not registered yet, so I'm looking very much forward to learn so much from this workshop. Thank you so much.
Good morning everyone, I'm Dr. Neha Bikshit from Department of Law, University of Rajasthan. I'm here to learn more and more research methodology as well as new techniques in the research methods. As this year I myself become the PhD guide, and therefore I require more and more information regarding the legal research, because I have to impart those knowledge to those students. Thank you so much.
Great. Actually, everybody is saying I have to learn, so I am reminded that we need to unlearn also learn.
Yes.
Because there are so many things we should have learned wrongly. So there is a need to clarify, need to... Actually, this always happens. I found in other workshops that people come with a lot of misconceptions. So removing those misconceptions is also very important. It will happen when I will come, we will come down to brass tacks, like how the hypothesis is constructed. Somebody say, why should, how many hypotheses should be there in a research? What is the difference between hypothesis and research question? Minor things, because it has to, you know, boil down to that level ultimately.
So it would be great.
Good morning everyone, my name is Nitya Thakur. I am teaching intellectual property law at KIT University Bhubaneswar. I'm also pursuing my PhD from IP University Delhi, which is also in intellectual property laws. I'm here for this workshop because I want to learn the finer nuances of legal research, and moreover the hands-on modules which we learn will help me to a great extent during my PhD. Thank you so much.
Good morning, I suppose. I'm also one of the youngest people here. I'm pursuing my LLB. Like, I'm in my last year right now, so I think I still have a long way to go and learn so many things. So I don't think I really have to unlearn anything, because I don't know anything about it. So yeah, that's about it. Thank you.
Good morning everyone, I'm Deeksha Munjal. Even though I've finished my PhD, I'm here to learn newer techniques such as that of Atlas TI and legal impact assessment, just to fine tune my further research. Thank you.
Great.
We have some colleagues sitting here, you know, so yeah. Should I introduce her? Would you?
Yes.
Sorry.
You should be visible to me.
Yes, I'll stand up and speak.
I didn't expect that they're gathering this. Anyway, yeah, please.
Good morning to you all. Myself, Dr. Jaya Matthew, my PhD in law, but teaching law to management students. Yeah. I'm in KJ Somaya Institute of Management Studies and Research, Mumbai. It is. And I am totally, unaware of empirical research methods. In my place, my faculty colleagues always boast of doing, this empirical, research using AMOS and SPSS. Yes. This time I just told them that I'll come back and I'll show you.
Very right.
Thank you.
Good morning to all of you. Myself, Dr. Gagandeep Kaur. I am Assistant Professor in College of Legal Studies, Petroleum University, Dehradun. I have only one reason to come here, that is Professor Vajpayee sir. Reason. I attended one FDP, and in that FDP sir was expert. And before that FDP, there was a myth that in legal research, empirical study is impossible. So I asked this question, and sir has clarified. There was hardly two sessions, and he started explaining. No, it is possible. It is a science. So I just want to learn all those things. So I am here to learn more about that empirical research in law.
How many are left in UPS?
The entire faculty is sitting here. No, I am very happy. You know, they are very good people. They are good friends.
Actually, I have been there in UPS. Fantastic place. Very. So this is the actually passion. I am telling you. These are all friends whom somewhere I met, sometime I met, here and there. We all know each other, except you. They will be also be in line with me, definitely. It's going to be. So it's a kind of connection, building connections. Yes.
I'm very much looking forward to this workshop, so that I will be able to produce
the work which will be referred by others. And so one more thing, I very much like your concept of musical evening.
Yes, because we are men of multi moods. You will realize it because I have very unconventional way of doing all these things. If you are expecting me to be highly orthodox and kind of typical teacher looking like, then that will not happen. Idea is to achieve our objective. So music is integral to that. We'll have it.
Thank you.
Yes. Anybody else? Now we have our own Hudi here.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Dr. Andrew Munin Singh. I'm a research associate at NLU Delhi. I've just completed my PhD. I was awarded in March only with the help of Professor Bajpayee again, because I learned SPSS software from him. Yes, I'm here to learn more about Atlas TI and other softwares also.
Hi, my name is Saru. I'm a faculty here teaching in the areas of intellectual property and communication.
Yes. Let me have this pleasure of introducing you. Sir Sachidananand is a very senior professor here. He teaches
constitutional law. He's the ex vice chancellor of American law industry at Chennai. And
we also have then Dr. Shankar, who is a teacher of.
Morning, thank you, sir. I am Shankar. I am teaching research in field of transnational commercial laws. Recently, I engaged in a research in was empirical research in drafting and enforcing international commercial contracts. I wish to continue and learn some more aspects in this workshop.
I'm G.S. Mann. I'm a student of research methodology. See, we have been talking about this compartmentalization of teaching and research. I think this notion may not be judicious. We do research every day. Knowingly and unknowingly, we do research. Manually, like the case, we do research. I think the degree varies. And number two, context is also very pertinent. See, that one again, we refer to this analysis of particular concept in isolation. The real problem is we don't integrate concepts. Number two, we don't practice the concepts. When we do research, our understanding is confined to objectives, research question. Now, how the research question can be framed and what the relevance of the research question to the finding and other problems? I think we should discuss,
yes,
analyze the particular subject in integrative manner, and then we should try to practice that specific concept. Otherwise, understanding would be confined to this specific plan of research methodology, A concept, B concept, or C concept. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Mark. Yes, we have Mr. Pension.
Take it
here, you are here.
Good morning, everybody. I'm Soma Rama Sarkar. I'm an assistant professor at Delhi Metropolitan Education, which is affiliated to IIT University. And currently, I'm pursuing my PhD in electronic waste. So from this workshop, I wish to learn more about empirical research, which is definitely going to help me in completing my PhD.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Tadja Singh, PhD scholar from Jamia Millia Islamia. Ritu Koshik,
burden of expectations. And but I truly am convinced and I am confident that at day 5th again we will sit and I will discuss with you what is your learning outcome, because I don't claim that the entire science of research methodology can be imparted in all these 5 days, because it is not possible. Research methodology is a full-fledged subject which we taught in a full semester. The only modest objective is first you to introduce into this, as Gagandeep was saying, that we need to believe that the empirical research is possible in law, all branches of law. We'll show you how the empirical research can be used in contract law, in tort law, in criminal law, in environmental law, in IPR, and all these. Arun is sitting here. So we are going to Scotland, I think, in next month, where we are jointly organizing a workshop, and they have invited mainly to tell how the empirical methodology is possible in IPR issues. So the things are expanding. We are actually, please refer 2 months ago, the American Journal of Legal Education, they have brought an article, subject specific research methodology and teaching. So they are now talking about, they have already accepted that research methodology is possible, but they are now discussing every subject has unique character. So what kind of legal material we are addressing? that would decide our approach. The choice of research methodology is guided by the nature of research problem that you have. You need not to be committed with a particular method. We need to identify which methodology suits according to the nature of research that you have. All these things are methodological aspect of research, and research methodology is not a whimsical thing. It's a science. The protocols of research methodology are already settled. It's not G.S. Vajpayee or anybody who will say it. So we will go by those. I will introduce you certain material also, which will help. And the idea is, I'm thinking very modestly that how a problem can be made researchable, how the different techniques can be put into use, what kind of temperament a researcher should have in order to do the research, what are the assumptions we should be having in your mind before embarking into the research, all these kinds of things. But this is the time, I think we are little behind the schedule now, to have this important round table, because we have two experts and also everybody. And the scheme is, we will have this round table in order to just familiarize ourselves with the canvas that we have, the platform that we have got, because in Indian context, the challenges for applying research methodology, the challenges for using research methodology, the impediment in using research methodology are many. So this is the time to listen from our experts, the critical issues in legal research in India. This is a kind of primer. I am calling it a primer. Idea is to introduce this subject. So the scheme would be, sir, basically we would be discussing what are the factors which are affecting the course of research methodology in India, what are the impediments, what are the positives, what are the negatives, how do you see the law schools in terms of their preparedness, whether they are equipped enough to promote research culture in the campus, and these kind of issues. So I think this would give some idea, and then we'll also involve you also. So I think we'll have 15 minutes each, speaking 15 to 20 minutes or whatever. So we would start with Professor Ishwar Bhatt. No, sir, that order is very hot. So we'll have 15 minutes from him, and then Professor Gurpur and Vinayal, and then we'll make it open for everybody to make contribution. And I would request that whatever consensus or whatever important points emerge, you please note down, because we have to prepare a report also in the end. Right. So, sir.
All the participants and the learned faculties of NLU Delhi. Professor Vajpayee has been passionately involved in training the researchers, developing this particular discipline in such a way that it will become a more full-fledged, and various techniques can be effectively used, and our toolkit will be quite comprehensive. Perhaps that is the contribution that Professor Vajpayee has been making during the last several workshops, and this is an ongoing task. Even in other law schools also, similar type of exercises are taking place, whether it's in the context of coursework or other special studies or special workshops or other types of activities. What are the factors which impede the development relating to research in the Indian context? About that, let me briefly point out. Then how various specific tools of a doctrinal legal research can be made quite strong. About that, I will explain. First, let me raise the issue that already referred by Professor Vajpayee. Do we have a legal research method of our own, or whether there is a distinct method called as a legal research method. There is one criticism by a very eminent scholar that law has no research methodology of its own. It just tries on the basis of the methods that are supplied by social science scholars or social science disciplines. Even doctrinal research also, they gather input from political science, sociology, or economics, and law has not developed any independent legal research method, because law is primarily a professional study. It is not academic study. Since it is not an academic discipline, it has not been able to develop a methodology of its own. Because what is required for profession? It is a catering. Whether it is to the profession, there is a litigation profession, or to various other spheres, it simply provides all such information to specialized bodies like law commissions or such bodies also. They rely upon the input from other disciplines, and they are not developing their own techniques. To this criticism, Professor Roger Cottrell answers that it's not correct to say that social scientists are colonizing the sphere of legal research. Legal scholars are developing the tools. They might be getting the influence from other disciplines, but it is unfair to say that legal research methodology is not an independent area. Insofar as research is concerned, no discipline can be regarded as independent. Can we say that economics is independent, or sociology is independent, or political science is independent? They are actually making use of the legal materials. They are making use of materials that are available, or the techniques that are available from various other disciplines. Insofar as law is concerned, doctrinal legal research is conducted in such a way that it has been able to establish some of the interpretative techniques of its own. Look to the analytical legal research techniques that are employed by the judges, or by lawyers, or by academicians. We find that it is something distinct from the techniques that are used by the social scientists. Then we find that about the interdisciplinary approach that is adopted by law commission, it is something distinct from the approaches adopted by other disciplines. When Justice J.S. Verma committee, in a span of 2 months, was able to produce a voluminous report on the use of such a thorough study with the help of a team of researchers. Yes, it was possible. It was not just on the basis of the borrowing made from the other disciplines that it was done. Thus, the resources are there, but the resources are not adequate. That's what I intend to point out, because when it comes to some of the specific areas, we find that the contribution from the side of legal scholars are inadequate. Recently, when relating to feminist legal research, I thought of writing a small article. I found that most of the feminist legal research works have been done by non-law scholars, sociologists, or from the field of say English, or economics, or social work, or political science, and rarely from the field of from the side of law. And some scholars in the field of law, I mean feminist scholars, might have written, but not relating to feminist issues, but relating to IPR or relating to various other areas. Of course, there are very less studies. Why is it that that kind of thing is to happen? The reason is that the feminist legal scholars are not developing a tradition of their own. If at all, a very prominent study, ethnographic study in field of law can be found. It is a Professor Pratiksha Bakshi's book on secrets of public law. Secrets of law. And public secret of law.
Public secrets of
rape law. See, it is a wonderful ethnographic study. Are we able to produce legal research of that standard?
See,
we find that we are not equipped with the adequate training, because the law school training relating to research methodology is relying on some old books or old articles or some of the books that are published in the Western world, and relating to the way in which feminist legal research is to be done today in the Indian context, we do not have adequate reading materials. How to conduct a policy research? Policy research in the field of law, we don't have materials. See, there is a distinct method of conducting a policy research. See, first of all, a statement of objectives, then the evaluative criteria relating to various policy alternatives, survey or mapping of policy alternatives, and cost-benefit analysis of each and every policy alternative, and ultimately choosing the best policy which is most convincing or most appropriate or which is more socially acceptable. That type of policy research in the field of law, about that we don't have material. Have any material on action research in law? There also we find lacking, because most of the action researchers are action research literature that can be found is from the field of social sciences. Actually, law is more action oriented, because unlike various other disciplines, economics or sociology or political science, law is put into action. Law can be put into action, and it is possible to remediate a situation. It is possible to bring certain improvement. See, we are not having such materials because we are not researched in that area, and our research guys have not motivated, or the research methodology literature producers are very less in number in the country. That's why we do not come across such a literature which can guide. And you are about comparative legal research. The way in which comparative legal research is conducted in various universities is not something inspiring. They juxtapose various legal provisions or legal positions, and a systematic analysis of the whole of the law with reference to some criterion of comparison, tertium comparativeness, is not taking place. What is a tertium comparativeness? And with reference to that tertium comparativeness, how the whole work is to be conducted, and how to evolve a tertium comparativeness. About that, we do not have guidance. Of course, we come across a very less number of literature in that area. Have we any literature on a historical method of conducting research in the field of law? There also we find that there is a lacuna. That's if you are to blame for inadequate equipment from the side of legal scholars to conduct a legal research adequately satisfying the requirements of the circumstances, perhaps I've got to blame the lacuna in the leadership that's provided. Of course, blame game can go on, but how we can actually contribute towards a creation of a materials relating to historical method of conducting legal research, policy research in the field of law, action research in the field of law, or a feminist legal research in India. Of course, sir, the best material that we can find is a Catherine Bartlett, famous book, a famous article in a Harvard Law Review. That's a feminist method of legal research, legal method, feminist legal method. See how far we have incorporated the ideas contained in that article in our research methodology syllabus. Or if it is possible to make some modifications or say various other adjustments or some additions to the materials that are that are produced by her. Perhaps that is one of the best way in which we can contribute or we can help the cause of feminist legal research. Bartlett, her article is a something a phenomenon because it has been cited by so many scholars and it has been applied and it has been commented and a lot of developments have taken place by relying on some of the essential techniques that are employed by her or suggested by her. There's a whether it's asking the woman question or raising the consciousness or say feminist method of positionality and various other things. Because there are so many positives and negatives, and of course, if we find that there is a lot of interest by various scholars from time to time, and it is increasing, then that gives a positive signal how there is a that an atmosphere, ambience for conducting a research in a most effective manner. From that angle, perhaps the trend of developments in various universities, not only national law universities, in traditional universities, in private universities, or in other law centers, which are recognized by the universities as research centers. That tendency is good, that show of interest is something that creates some kind of expectation. But we are lacking in some of the techniques. We have not developed adequate literature which can guide the scholars about the way in which research could be conducted. From this angle, what Professor Bajpai has been doing is something that should be appreciated. And about some of the aspects like comparative legal research or historical legal research or analytical legal research or policy research and action research. Of course, I had written some articles and they have been published either in ILA journal or Karnataka State Law University journal or in some other journals, even about multi-method legal research also. It's essential to consolidate the gains of those types of efforts, not only from the side of national authorities, but also from the side of various universities, so that there should be systematic effort. And the criticism that law has not developed an independent research method of its own is something to be addressed by a fitting reply through scholarly writings, scholarly involvement, and scholarly efforts. With this, let me conclude. Thank you. Sir, and you please keep your observations or comments ready. And can somebody be voluntary to moderate this in the process of you can? How I will do?
So you were talking about that feminist legal research.
No, actually discussion you will take later, because let everybody speak. I'm saying that you discuss in the end, but meanwhile you can keep your comments ready or observations, so we'll involve everybody in discussion. With this, we approach to the next speaker. So, now, a presentation.
Good morning, everybody. And teacher, Dr. Ishwar Bhatt, and all my dear colleagues, it's such a pleasure to come back to a research method discussion. As a prelude to the lengthy, detailed proceedings that may follow later on, this roundtable has been organized, and I congratulate Dr. Vajpayee on his vision and expertise. I'm sure that he has revolutionized the landscape of legal research in India, and I hope that although the work has been very recent, in no country it has evolved all of a sudden. You know, US or UK had centuries of legal research and education tradition before they embarked on the journey of setting the standards for legal research. Of course, for Indian context, things are very, very different, and that's going to be my presentation. Let us just think a few things. First of all, the background of Indian context, and what are the issues and challenges. My submission is that the very focus of legal education in India itself, in a developing country, being a country which has come into its own legal system and democracy, opening up to democracy in only last 60 plus years, has been about churning products for the court-centric justice administration. I'm emphasizing, court-centric justice administration. How much of justice issues or conflict issues approach the court? Only 10%. What happens to the 90%? Has the legal research or legal education bothered about it? It has, time and again, with Dr. Menon, Dr. Ranveer, etc., or Professor Bhatt, but not in a very systematic way. My country is one type of country, and I am always in the hawa of trying to create world-class research. Where my Indian reality is not very much investigated into, or investigated only at certain spells of, you know, or so-called islands of investigation. Second is, we are turning products for in-house lawyering, whether it is in the corporate or NGO or whatever. Lawyers are too numerous, maybe more than rats in the laboratory, to encounter, so it's very difficult to tackle the landscape of legal education beyond the creation of lawyers. So this is where we stand as far as legal education is concerned. Legal research need not be always built within the legal education citadels. It can be independent as well. India has had one such institute, ILI, now going in the legal education way, producing graduates and postgraduates. What is happening to our country? Now, just to take a little shift to the best of the reports which has come in the recent years regarding quality of legal education, called as Educating Lawyers, from the Carnegie, so-called Carnegie report. With the combination of experts from various universities in the US, they lament that legal education always looked up to medical education in terms of being a professional education. Dr. Bhatt highlighted it. Now, the lamentation is that it hasn't been as ethical, the focus hasn't been as clinical as medical education ought to have been. You know, the very method of case studies started with the medical education, doctors writing the case notes of patients, which was imitated by us lawyers in Landel's learned exposition in terms of case studies. And then it migrated into other disciplines, whether it is management education, because Harvard Management School, the famous school in the world, followed Harvard Law School the very next year. So the evolutionary landscapes, etc., if you notice, the methodological migration also has been there. Now, if you look at the medical education or healthcare, medical education, medical practice is within the larger metric of healthcare. What about the legal care? Do we think in that way? Because if you look at Human Development Index, education, healthcare, etc., have been some of the parameters. Even access to justice is a parameter. Have we looked at law, legal education, and legal research from that broader, from the broader world or canvas that it should be in? You know that in medicine, the focus was always, especially in public health care, the shift was always on what? It was on preventive approach. Preventive approach in terms of vaccination, eliminating epidemics, etc. They have moved from preventive to palliative and finally to integrative. You know, they have integrated various approaches to medicine. Today you have the Ayush, etc. Do we have any parallel developments in legal field? Or legal practice, we have some. For example, alternative dispute resolution being integrated into the institutes of judiciary or institutes of justice or the structures of justice, entry inroads into the legal education and very little into legal research. For example, he's talking about dispute resolution. Now, this kind of focus, if you look at the way the law is working, the way the legal education is connecting to that, and the way the dispute resolution, which is the major engagement of judiciary is, and the judiciary dabbling itself in legal education, trying to control legal education, the profession trying to control, has been controlling legal education. So where are we? Don't you think that one of the reasons why we haven't come out with a very integrated, tight, structured protocol in legal research is because we have so many masters to answer, because we have not reflected? So this is, for me, a biggest challenge, a critical issue as far as legal research in India is concerned. The other issue is about revenue, sustenance and expectation, because law research is situated within the law schools where large percentage of revenue comes from undergrad education, and the focus has been on undergrad education, and the focus is on professionalism of undergrad education. It has a respect. Its autonomy is protected, but then that has become its limitation as well. Therefore, major focus goes on training teachers to teach good law, to make them clinically adept, etc. Now, the other limitation that we have as far as India is concerned is the lack of exclusive research body, or the bodies which are controlling us not having a clue about what legal research is. Because if you look at the profession, or if you look at the judiciary, the research has always been ad hoc. The case in hand, the evidence is in hand, expectations of the clients, the necessary protocols that they have to follow in arriving at the decision making, they seem to dominate the landscape of legal research. Now, the free hand, the autonomy, the openness that the academic should have doesn't seem to be entering into the mainstream discourse of legal education, legal research. So, there is a need for an exclusive research body which consolidates all these and gives us a rich menu or choices of how to conduct legal research, what are the best practices, what are the possibilities. Now, the dichotomy in the UGC and DCI approaches, I mean, we have an American Bar Association in the US, which wonderfully has conducted many reports. For example, sir was talking about feminist research methods. Deborah Rode, the Stanford scholar, has conducted research on the gender equality dimensions in legal profession. If you read that report, it's so comprehensive, so well articulated, so well analyzed. Applying the principles of sexual harassment or equality principles to the area of legal profession, etc., have been done. How much of research the law schools or the lawyers' body, the Bar Council, has conducted on legal profession itself? We don't have, if I want to prepare my students for profession, I don't have a single document which talks to me about competency matrix for lawyers, skills required for lawyers, the way the profession has evolved, the profiles of lawyers, how did they evolve? I talk to one or two and I go and tell these cock and bull stories to students and try to inspire them. So as a law school, when I am trying to get my materials in education and in my approach also, the research is lacking. Now, coming to the issue of combining other methods in legal research, I have got certain examples. For example, in Jawaharlal Nehru University, wonderful research is happening as far as international law is concerned. I have had the privilege of evaluating some of Professor Chimney's guided research. Professor Chimney himself has written about the international law in the neoliberal era, and the problem of the globalization as far as developing countries are concerned. I mean, that's a primary doctrinal fundamental research. Now, if you try to apply that in any context of how international law is working in India or influencing in India, impacting in India, very surely certain impact pathways can be developed out of that, either doctrinally or empirically. Similarly, I have had the experience of conducting a policy study with one legislator in Karnataka on the plight of sex workers, and we were able to come out with certain recommendations, and we were able to convince the government to make budgetary allocation. Now, when we did that research, it was exactly what Professor Bhatt said, multi-method research we applied. We had to do the triangulation of the data, etc. On the other hand, if you look at Indian recent developments like the Mental Health Act, deriving itself from the United Nations Convention on Disability is another interesting development. That means that there is something happening, but it is not happening in a very linear fashion or in a coherent manner, as I told you already. Now, West Bengal government came out with the Healthcare Establishment Act. In many ways, this legislation is a path-breaking legislation, but you could clearly see how the legislation in some parts has lifted portions of Obamacare and brought it out. Now, this is exactly where you see that when you do the analysis, there is a need for creating proper research process or protocols, at least basic document. Dr. Vajpayee has tried to do it successfully. It has inspired many legal researchers. Now, because methodology is unstated, not stating the methodology has been the fashion of doctrinal legal research. One of the main trends or one of the main characteristics of doctrinal legal research is not mentioning the methods at all. Now, is that correct? Is methodology being unstated going to give a free hand to the researcher, or is that a discipline in which Anglo-American traditions and European traditions have trained themselves and therefore we follow? What is the danger of missing the critical realities? Are realities which warrant attention? What about design thinking of our students, like the molding of the minds to do the research thinking? Because research is a lot to do with thinking. You have to master the skills of evaluative, critical kind of thinking. Has that been taught as part of the legal research methodology curriculum? I don't think any institute has got anything on that. I don't know how many of you are aware of Six Thinking Hats concept, Edward de Bono's design thinking idea, or in our own Indian Akanksha method, which is far superior to Socratic method. We have the Vedic method of thinking, the Mimamsa methods. We haven't incorporated these. So what are we talking in terms of creating our own imprint in the landscape of legal research? Now, ILI, I told you already about ILI. So there is a greater reality. A greater reality is asking for our legal research in India to be looking at values, to be looking at ethics, to be responding to the environment of innovation which is simmering in the country. Now, on the other hand, if you look at our political system in the current context, one researcher says, he's a Swedish researcher, he says that many a times the politics speaks of legal research or law, like how the drunk is looking for the lamppost. So when they're very drunk, they miss their way, so they look at the lamppost and then they forget that there was a lamppost. Similarly, our policymakers, our legislators refer to law in a passing by manner. Ultimately, what determines their decisions is so many other undercurrents. So today, when we are looking at law, we are looking in terms of sources. So this researcher raises a question, are we looking at only sources or should we also look at causal factors? For example, we say that this legislation has been implemented because there was a felt need and the judiciary in one of the decisions has highlighted the need for such a legislation. But is it that? Look at the very Uniform Civil Code debate now. Is it only about judicial decision? Yeah, wasn't judicial decision forthcoming in the past as well? Or is it the opportune political moment? Is it only the lamppost for the drunk? The time will tell. So, or recently we have had the innovation policy by the government of India. Whether the innovation policy is talking about this very debate of citation index versus patenting? No, it doesn't even touch that issue, which is a major issue where scientists like J.C. Bose lost the cutting edge advantage for Indian innovation environment. So, if you look at the Law Commission work also, we can have two possible approaches. One is the institution-based top-down approach of law reform, and the other one is the communitarian consultative approach. India is a communitarian country. Asian countries are communitarian. Whether law commission is communitarian, law commission's approaches are consultative. How many consultations are there? Professor Singh was insisting so in the Delhi Law School, there was a consultation. I sponsored one consultation in Pune. Earlier, Dr. Menon gathered many law schools to do the consultation. Do they do it as mandatory part of their work? Just has anybody done this research? If you research, if you do a meta-analysis of the working of the law commission, as far as India is concerned, vis-a-vis Australia, UK, US, this is where comparative research comes in. There is a very dismal track record of communitarian or consultative approach. So, on the other hand, I'm not going to be pessimistic all the time. I want to tell you that even in the judicial review of legislations or judicial review of governance, etc., most of the time it is cognitive. It's what comes before the court, what is discussed in the court. Metacognitive way of looking at things is rarely brought out. Today, if you're looking at research on justice system, one of the participants here was talking about performance index. If you're talking about serious research on justice system, if you're talking about impact pathways, if you're talking about critical analysis, evaluative analysis, we really need to gear up as far as India is concerned. There are poor attention to emerging fields such as innovation, neurobiology, and law. What is this neurobiology, MRI scans of juvenile, so-called juvenile delinquents? Is it factored into legal decision? How many cases? Is there any discussion in the judicial colleges on this issue? Normativity, authority and legitimacy of law. I was reading a very interesting research because I presented a paper in New Zealand on therapeutic justice in India. And in that context, I come from the coastal Karnataka, where people submit their disputes to the so-called deity, which is impersonated by a human being. The person gets possessed and people bring their disputes. So there was a very good analysis by a German sociologist on this issue. So I was looking into that. He develops the entire analysis based on Rawls's concept of justice. And he says that in this kind of system, how people seek their solutions or how people seek resolution of dispute, they are not looking at rules, they are looking at justice, they are looking at equilibrium, they are looking at maintenance of social order. So, while talking of that, where is authority, where is the legitimacy coming from to this impersonator? So, this kind of research on the legitimacy and the authority of law, legitimacy and authority of justice, the way in which there is a cleavage between the systemic justice and the way the citizens are receiving or participating in the justice process, don't you think there is a growing cynicism? Why? Because there hasn't been the diagnosis of the issue. We have simply imported, and we have not looked at how it has impacted. We have a very interesting piece by S.N. Jain, which was written long, long ago. In that piece, S.N. Jain talks about this issue and the research being triggered by Indian Law Institute. But I don't think it ended anywhere, you know. Because if it was, then there ought to have been reviews of the justice system. There ought to have been reviews of why our constitution hasn't reached the deeper recesses of our nation. Does the constitution mean the same to every Indian citizen, 125 crore Indian citizens? The other issue that is very challenging is, if you are measuring excellence and quality, what should be the measurement as far as India is concerned? Should it be journals, impact factor? Should it be peer review? Should there be a research assessment exercise at all India level as far as law is concerned? Should there be a separate one? Because UGC treats us at par with social sciences and humanities, whereas Bar Council treats it as a professional discipline. So there's a real divergence in the approaches. What is the role of technology? Already it has been highlighted. How do we globally benchmark our research? What about other global scholars reflecting on India? What about cross-border research? So, if you are trying to benchmark Indian research, we have a comparative context today with globalization, and there are certain best practices. So, if you are doing comparative context, one issue that I would highlight is indigenous justice and the Indian factors. Because India is, if you look at demographically, almost 55 to 60% of India is disadvantaged or not yet mainstreamed kind of people. What is their justice need? How are they looking at law? How are they looking at justice? Second, look at the current Indian reality. Very poor human development index, very high poverty index, vulnerability. In the vulnerability, we have farmers, victims of trafficking, vagaries or extremes of globalization impact, crimes, community resources, community resources either being usurped by the government or being allocated for projects. Human suffering, as Dr. Bakshi has put it already, huge variations and gaps in development. What is the role of the law as a regulator, as a facilitator, and as a liberator? How much of legal research is focusing on that? Are we choosing our topics on that basis? Or are we reflecting in our topics, in our respective topic, on this reality of India? Second is the thematic focus, which we are having in Indian legal research. If you look at US and EU, they are moving more in the line of global justice, compliances, because there is a large number of people being employed by their multinational companies elsewhere. The media, how the media have impacted, because that's one of the causal factors. If you're talking about only sources as legislation and precedents, what about the way the media impact? Privatization of war, because war is getting increasingly privatized. Climate change, nuclear power, diversity, equality, sustainability, working of course, conflict resolution, collective resources and migration. Now these are the problematic issues in India as well. You all were talking about your research topics, but I did not see much of a resonance of where globe is moving, where India is contextualized in terms of the topics that you have chosen. So what are the alternatives? I have raised all these issues and I'm also reflecting on solutions. One is that we have to create unique protocols, like Dr. Vajpayee has created a handbook. Similarly, National Law School Bangalore has created a citation guide for India. Now, in what way it is unique? It might be a hybrid between Harvard and OSCOLA, the Oxford method, not more than that. How do we validate Indian resources? How do we validate Indian citation within that citation approach? What is our research ecosystem? How do we create research ecosystem? Now, there's a fantastic research ecosystem that we are witnessing here. But is this the case in all other law schools or all other universities as far as legal research is concerned? What kind of journals are we prescribing? How many colloquia are being held at different levels of research development? Is there a national network of guides or national network of legal researchers? What about the sub-networks, maybe criminal law, global legal studies, etc.? What about when you present your research, whether doctrinal, non-doctrinal or combination methods, are you having stakeholder engagement and validation of your finding? Are you verifying it with a policymaker? Are you verifying it with a lawyer? Are you verifying it with a judge? And is it reflected in your evaluative approach before you finalize your findings? You know, how many of you have done that, those who have the PhD? Has anybody done that, engaging the stakeholder and taking validation? Yes, one has done. One more. Good. So, how have we done it? Then, status report of legal research. Like, for the first time after 10 years, I compiled our LLM dissertation abstracts, and I was dismayed to see that 50% of the abstracts are not even kept in order, although we insisted on that. So documenting, compiling, evaluating and seeing whether your research and the national vision or the global vision are going in the same way is what we have to see. What kind of outcome it can have for the issue of human vulnerability. I'll go one step further from Dr. Bakshi, human vulnerability rather than as much as human suffering. The globally, nationally salient themes, peer teams and reviews, mutually reviewing. Like one of the ways by which I created research ecosystem in Symbiosis Law School was collecting best practices from the places I have been in the past in Europe and US and listed them and tried to implement them with my colleagues. One of them was peer mentoring and peer reviewing. So the junior researcher would evaluate senior researcher and vice versa, and creating little subgroups within the institute. In the beginning, we had only two articles coming from the faculty in a year. Today, in a matter of 6 years, we have 250 publications. So how could it come about? It was a passion, it was teamwork, it was co-authoring, it was complementarity, it was cross-border. By cross-border, I mean you crossing the discipline. You are a constitutional lawyer. You can always reflect on the constitutionality of the aspect that your colleague is doing in IP or in corporate law, or human rights angle. These are mandatory, you know, as value dimension. Now, Indian Council for Legal Research is what I'm proposing. I have been harping on this in the Rajya Sabha presentation. I said this. This was the idea which evolved out of our deliberation in Gangtok under the leadership of Dr. Menon and Professor Chinni. We brought out the Gangtok Declaration. Even Professor Rajkumar from Jindal was present. So, we say that just like Indian Council for Medical Research, today it should be integrative medicine, so like that integrative law, and pursue competitive state grant rather than current salami approach. Current approach is salami, you know, one grant broken into pieces, a little bit to Delhi National Law School, a little bit to Bangalore, a little bit to West Bengal National Law School. Instead of that, you create Indian Council for Legal Research, which will look at the quality, which will look at protocols, which will standardize, which will address the nuances and the gaps. And then to cascade developments across India. I'm very heartened to see today, all those who are around the table are those who believe in the leadership of NLU Delhi to cascade its best practices and rich resources to the law schools in the region. I mean, this was the very aim with which second generation legal reforms were, consultations were held. So it's actually happening in practice. But this kind of cascading has to happen regionally, state-wise, and to maintain standards, because anything cannot pass off as legal research. There are certain requirements. People don't even seem to know in some cases, you know, what Bar Council report, CDC report said that there are three tiers of law schools. We have many tiers of legal research as well in India. Internationalization of legal research with cross-border idea exchange and exploring collaborative projects. Of course, we have an example here of empirical legal studies with Cornell University, many others as well. We also have some collaborative studies. Law in a globalizing context in certain areas could be a matter of critical study. If not to provide the data to those people to write papers, us controlling our papers with their ideas coming in and sharing the credit could be the option. So this is the blueprint that I had created for a model for Indian Council for Legal Research. It could operate from Delhi, or it could be an independent body with its regional arms in NLUs, or NLUs themselves taking it up as part of Excellence Drive. And with approved research centers in areas, like for example here I see IP, corporate and environment. I will focus on global legal studies and in symbiosis, you know, we are looking more at feminist studies and global legal studies. Second could be capacity building and HR, research fellows, professor emeritus, visiting scholars and chairs. Third is evaluative review system for both profession as well as curriculum, audit and review of legal education and justice system, research projects, journals, conferences, law reform research in particular. Fourth is special and approved centers in public law, private law, technology and innovation law, HDI, governance and rule of law, one of the most obscure areas as of now. Justice deliverance system, international global legal dimensions. The last facet, fifth facet I suggest within this model is consultation, training and extension as well as outreach, where we could look at IP and innovation in terms of cross-disciplinary approach, inter-ministerial policies and papers, continuing and professional legal education, faculty development program, interdisciplinary research, consultation, training, community legal literacy programs. So this is almost similar to the agenda of Indian Council for Medical Research, but little bit more because law is very closely bound up with state, nation state system and governance system. So the areas are much vaster. Even Indian Council for Medical Research could be the critical topic for Indian Council for Legal Research. So that's the power of law. So that is where I would end giving these solutions and raising these issues. And thank you for the opportunity.
Well, this is clearly a very vast canvas that you have portrayed to document and map all critical important developments which are very important to the, which are very central to the entire discourse on legal research methodology. Friends, and next, just to carry forward this conversation, just I will pinpoint a couple of points from this discussion, and then we can make this session open so that everybody could contribute. As far as I am concerned, I have just two, three very brief points to make to be able to again contextualize the entire discussion so that our all subsequent session becomes automatically relevant. My first, since we are discussing the critical issues in legal research in India, we need to be aware that somehow the method is not central to the legal studies. That is the main issue. Our entire law teaching curriculum approach does not really centralize the very idea of methodology to its sub-disciplines of law. And therefore, we find that the necessary skills do not get developed in the process of learning law. why it is happening. We are not very method conscious people, basically, as far as our entire approach to the subject is concerned. Because it's none of your fault, because in the morning you all have admitted that you do not have much exposure into legal research methods. Why? Though you all have completed your education. No? So there is a paradox. Here the paradox lies, and we must make ourselves aware that this methodology is not something which you could learn by the way. There has to be a very conscious and very dedicated efforts in terms of understanding. Because in the other parts of the world, the research methodology is getting very, very specialized. Depending on the challenges that you have in terms of a particular research problem, the choice of research methodology would be according to that particular subject. So that is the level of specialization. Here we are struggling with the basic proposition to identify research methodology in the law teaching curriculum. Identify means that is the first step. Now, why? What is happening, and why that is happening? Because, to my mind, I think a couple of occasions I have said this thing in different fora, that we are, by our all orientation, quite content-driven people. So our all studies are always we gear to learn something, and we are satisfied with the content. We do not have any training or any idea or any attitude to understand the underlying method which is reported in that particular document. So your all readings are geared to understand the content of a document. We never need to understand the method which is underlying. So knowing method is a very important thing that we have to admit. And you see the disciplinary growth, the discipline of the future of any discipline lies in the fundamental research. And somehow the fundamental research in law is not really happening. So therefore, if you see whatever tradition that Shashikala Gurupur has discussed in the Western world, they have developed, they clearly identified the legal research into two broader realms. They said the rhetoric of law, and they said the reality of law. So they said rhetoric of law means you are talking the normative law, and you are looking at the black letter law as it is. Now, law as it is not very inspiring, because you are taking it for granted. It is simply applied by the institution, and you become the consumer of all what is rhetorically available. So we are consumer of that level, where our entire engagement is predominantly limited to our understanding about the normative law. So our discourses and our all engagement with so-called research is limited to address the questions related to normative. We never move toward the reality of the law, which is the context of law, which Professor Shashikala Gurupur has pointed out. Because the moment you move to understand the reality of law, means you are trying to appreciate various external factors, which may be external to the legal system, but then they are very crucial to the several kinds of outcomes in the process. Now, because we, by presumption, assume that the entire discourse of law, the entire outcome in the legal process is related to the internal factors. Like, for instance, that is why they say law in research and research in law and research about law. Research in law is something which follows a very plain, you know, route, where we are looking at the doctrinal model, because you are searching your paradigms within the framework of law. So research in law is quite limited to the doctrinal model of law, because you are only exploring the doctrines of that particular subject, presuming that no other factor is relevant in any associated outcome that you are looking at. Like, for instance, if I say dependency in criminal court. So pendency in criminal court can be approached and can be studied merely by looking at the nature of law, the criminal procedure. But if you, so you will reach to definite conclusion. Like, for instance, if I say my hypothesis is the frequent adjournments are the major cause of pendency in the court. You can definitely take this presumption ahead and take this hypothesis forward in terms of collecting the data and understanding the manner in which the adjournments are granted. But if I take you to the external
facet of this discussion and talking about research about the law. There could be various factors located outside the purview of the legal system, but then they become very relevant. So do you have any mechanism or any framework or any methodology to appreciate those factors? Like, for instance, many people say media trial is a very important factor on the part of a judge to reach a particular conclusion. Now in Nirbhaya's recent decision, this is a major hypothesis, and something happened. Whether it was purely a legal outcome, whether the judge have purely evaluated the case on its merits by looking at the factors, and they have rightly balanced the mitigating and aggravating factors, or have, because they have made a statement that ultimately we have to send a message to the society. What does it translate to? It is mentioned, the judge says that ultimately we have to send a message to the society. In the US, I was going through Lisa Beblet. Lisa Beblet is a very, you know, unique, and Olen. Lisa Beblet, Olen, and Terry. These are few researchers. They have mentioned a very interesting situation. I'm just decoding from Nirbhaya's. They say, essentially, in every judgment, there is a social fact statement. Now, what is that social fact statement, and how does the judge derive that social fact statement? And judge essentially make a number of social fact statements pertaining to any situation. Now, they, for instance, they say that in Sangeet versus Haryana, they said the mood of the society is also a very important factor in deciding the question. So they said it is the judge-centric sentencing, it is a criminal-centric, or it is a crime-centric. So you are looking at social variables also. Now, whether judge is rightly decoding the social mood, because judge is also a person. He is also doing a kind of induction or deduction, something he is doing. So in making. So if you study the origin of any judgment, our social fact statements, like, you know, so many issues, social issues are before the bench, and they are making a lot of statements. Now, how they are making those statements? Are they dependent on empirical realities? Are they are judges' own creation? Because I said in the beginning that legal research is highly loaded in terms of opinion, impression, views, and ideologies. We are too loaded that we have almost treat them as correct. Because our loading is so powerful that we never allow any other alternative opinion to be in. So similarly, judge does this reasoning at the time of sentencing. How far that reasoning is correct? In the US, they have developed a risk assessment tool. They have developed a software to assist the sentencing process. And they said there can be 20-50 factors, and all those factors can be analyzed. It's not that the risk assessment tool will make the sentencing decision, judge will make, but it is assisted. Because a human being is doing the analysis of factors, being mitigating or being aggravating. So how this decoding is happening? My problem is, a lot of legal research has to go in making the study of social fact statements made by the judges in crucial issues. And I'm telling you, for me, the major source of hypothesis could be the Supreme Court judgments for Lawson. We are not using as very important hypothesis. Lot of hypothesis can be derived from various judgments of the Supreme Court. And let those judgments and those statements can be taken as hypothesis to be studied on a sample, and to arrive at a conclusion, and to confront and contradict then the reasoning made by the court. This can be important. You said something?
Yes. Can I?
Just a minute, I will finish it, and you have all opportunity. So I mean to say that this can be a very important situation. Second is, in terms of our positioning as a scholar in different history, who are we? Are we doer? Are we user? Are we critic? There are three positions that you can take in legal research. Either you can be a doer of research, you can be a user of research, or you can be a critic to research.
We need to listen. So mostly the doer part is missing. We are decisive here and there. I need to say, we are into too much of a macro. So our narrative is always very macro narrative, what I call it. Macro narrative or meta narrative, what postmodernists call it. They say, so legal research is getting into a shape of meta narrative, where broad brush style and very broad comments we make. And our ability not to go to the micro level things and issue. Like for instance, if I say, what is the postmodernist explanation of talaq or any issue? You can explain me for half an hour. If I say, can you calculate the average? Or can you create a frequency table? Creating a frequency table and talking about postmodernism explanation of a thing, both the things are very relevant in legal research. But somehow we are missing our spot. Seriously, not being able to come to the micro issues. Therefore, our grip, our precision, our rigor is losing. And most of the time I find the inability of the researcher to come to the core issue is a serious methodological question. Because if you leave the canvas very macro, you won't be able to pinpoint anything. And later on, you will find and realize that your comment is methodologically lacking. I'll give just one example of Law Commission's death penalty report, and later on I'll switch off. We examined that report, and I find certain things very interesting. And that report, several questions were there. Most of the time it was discussed from the viewpoint of law. This article which I have published in the newspaper is circulated. And there I'm saying that the conclusion reached by the law panel and the material relied did not match on a strict methodological logic. So they are deriving the conclusion which is not matching to the material that they have examined. Now this gap is a serious methodological question. I am telling you seriously, I have developed a tool, what I call it methodological comment. We write case comment. I think we should learn how to write a methodological comment on majority of the report. So in fact, law researchers are not making a methodological comment on the law commission report. They are engaging what is the legality, what are the cases. Had somebody made any methodological comment, the things would have gone very difficult for the law commission, because whatever conclusions they have drawn, they didn't match with the material relied. Nor there was a methodological logic, figuring in a reasonable way. So therefore, this is the situation of official research. I am telling you today, if a follow-up is made with most of the law commission report on the plane of methodology, not on the plane of any legal thing, you will find half of their reports are not sustainable, not tenable at all. Because what you defend, I always say in all your researches, when you do your PhD or your LLM dissertation, you never defend your content. You always defend your method. If method is successfully defended, the contents are automatically defended. That is the importance of method. So most of the time, if you start questioning the methods applied in law research, you will find a lot of issues. So therefore, what I am saying, you do a small thing, don't do a big thing, international thing, putting corruption in India kind of thing research. No, you do a small, ability to find a small topic is a great ability that we will discuss in later. And just I am
leaving it here. Tell you only one issue. Okay, leave it. I think I'll in next session we'll do. So a lot of restatement is possible, and mostly because we are not generating primary data. That is the situation. Because we don't have primary data on most of the things. So we are making a statement based on our hunch and guessing, mostly. If dependable primary data is a serious issue in the legal reality. And therefore, we are bereft of any, platform or any, serious stuff on which we can, base our conclusion. So therefore, I'm finding legal research in a very difficult situation. And I think the main issue is, as I am again and again saying, basic training of research methodology is missing in all curriculum. I'm telling you how to prepare a hypothesis, how to identify a research problem, how to generate a tool for data collection, how to analyze the collected data, how to create tables, like I'll make you here, like I'll give you the data, make a table,
You can give a half an hour lecture or 1 hour lecture on jurisprudence, but you cannot create a table. You cannot create a calculate an average. So the things which cannot be measured, they do not exist. So last thing is ability to make observation in law. It's something that we need to find. Every subject in law, in every subject of law, observations are possible. In every subject of law, measurement is possible. In every subject of law, data collection is possible. In every subject of law, empirical research is possible. This is the positive note with which I am leaving the floor, and we have we are meeting. The Anup is also there. He is also engaged in recently on the death penalty, mental health issue. He is researching, and he has already completed it. So we will make some contribution as to what is, you know, what are the factors which are affecting the state of empirical legal research. Mr. Mann is fisting for
a while. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So try to
call you. We are discussing contemporary challenges of legal research in India, right? Okay, now I think I believe there are certain policies which are required to be followed. Number one, right person at right place can do wonders. Like, I think that expertise of person should be taken into consideration for any kind of assignment, whether it is teaching assignment or research. Appointment should also be done according to that. Number two, see, non-performer should be taken to task, like that accountability of the non-performer. And performer should be rewarded. Now, there are various issues when it comes to ground realities. Terms and conditions of employment of all the teachers, like so many teachers are employed in private institutions, how they are being treated, whether they get sufficient time to do research or not. See, we should take into consideration the ground realities. Then only you would be in a better position to promote quality of a legal research in India. This is my humble submission. Thank you, sir. I'll lecture.
Thank you. Thank you. All the best for your very good and thoughtful inputs. With this, I Anup, you want to say something? You can say something, because I really appreciate the work that you have done. He's a very able colleague. So, any remark or anything before I?
We are just issue raising session.
Yeah. So thank you so much. As Professor Bajpayee said, much of my work is on the death penalty, and the work we've done involves interviewing all of India's death row prisoners and their families, and our current big project is on mental health of death row prisoners, which, as you say, is very cross-disciplinary. We're working with NIMHANS on that, and the challenges are so different in terms of this cross-border as to what is relevant for the law and what is relevant for psychiatry or what is relevant for psychology. It's been such a steep learning curve for us, and we find ourselves as legal researchers unable to have that conversation about the demands of a different field are very different. The demands of what clinical psychologists or psychiatrists want out of this, or how this should be done, is very different from how we as lawyers think it must be done. Be it on personality disorders, be it on IQ, be it on intellectual disability. What is relevant for the law is often may not be useful there. And I completely agree with Professor Gurpur that that learning of the other discipline teaches you a lot about the limitations of how you approach a certain issue in the law. And say, very simply, something like in the previous study that we did, we wanted to find out how many death row prisoners are poor in this country, right? Now, it was fascinating for me as to, you can't, if you go and ask a prisoner, what was your last income, right? You're asking a death row prisoner who's been in prison for, from anywhere between few months to 25 years, the response is, haan, hum kama lete the, khana kha lete the. Now, how will you convert that into
numbers?
You can't, and they don't remember that, right? They don't have a monetary value to that. Haan, main hum khet tha, khet se used to get whatever was required. Now, as a researcher, how do you convert? It's a serious mythological issue. And we said, okay, we can't put out figures on poverty. Right? What we can put out is on economic vulnerability, right? Because poverty brings out very technical definitions, right? There are established parameters for in economics in development economics as to what is poverty, right? So we had to find out, okay, what was their last employment? And then we said, okay, let's look at the last category of employment. Was it manual employment? Was it skilled? Was it unskilled? Was it a government employment? Was what level of education was required? So, and I'm saying that there are all these, while as a researcher, as somebody who has a certain view on the death penalty, I would love to put out the number that so many people are poor, but we just can't collect that data. And you have to be honest about that. And then you have to answer a very different question and look at it very differently then. I'll leave it at that. And I think one thing I would say in addition to all that has been said, especially in the kind of research that we do, access is a huge issue. I guess Ma'am has spoken about it. It's incredible how difficult it is and how much chasing we have to do with each state government to get access to prisons in this country.
Yes, actually now this floor is open. You can make your submissions, or it is your turn.
So we forget about facts, we forget about historical data. So whenever we ask people to prepare projects, they will be all around, this is the case law, this is what the interpretation is dealing with this provision. So that importance which should have been given to academics is lacking, I guess. That's the reason why legal research is lacking, and it should be put in that manner. What I suggest is,
strategically, it's quite important to not to part company with the case law, but use it like medicine. You should
put it in either literature review or in the background or in the, when you are writing project proposal.
Without that, it wouldn't be considered as legal proposal.
Charuji, I have a different opinion on that. My whole issue is we are not probably,
decoding those case laws
in a more methodological way. As I said, we can use Atlas TI in extracting the social factor statement made in the OBITA. We can do various kinds of analysis, even translating it into numbers. You know, I'll show you in Atlas TI when we'll be, how the textual analysis can be taken to a different level. You are doing manually, and you are yourself guided by your own fancies in while reading a case. I am saying that is my whole issue, that there can be better ways to decode these cases by using software, by using the doctrinal methodology, like for instance, discourse analysis, the logical induction. All these methods are there, but somehow that methodological rigor is missing. We don't know. Like, what methodology you follow while reading the case? No methodology. You are just reading the case and you are trying to manually. You cannot. After reading 4-5 cases, you will forget the first case. Suppose you have read 20-30, it's not manually manageable. I'm telling you, it's not possible. So there is a method of mapping the codes, mapping the themes, creating the stories and all those kinds of things. So what is the discourse? What is the grounded theory emerging from all that? I think we need to reach to that level. That is my entire problem, and I'm persistent about it. But there can be now been, because our brush with text cannot be put aside, as she said. But we need to find out some innovative ways to deal with text. That is my own point. Yeah, please.
Yes.
So we were discussing that. Why feminist legal research is not happening, and why legal lawyers or let's say legal academicians are not taking up that feminist issues. So what my observation is that many of the time we people are only concerned with the rhetoric and not with the reality. Like, so for a very, very simple example, like when we talk about women laws or when we talk about women property laws. Now we are very happy that our Hindu Succession Amendment Act has now given gender equality to women also. They also have equal women rights, property rights, everything. But when we see the reality, then actually in the kind of social background we have, social background, society, patriarchal system, are our own parents, even though the law allows women to have equal rights, but are the all parents actually giving property rights to their daughters? No. And so many of the time, the kind of society, majority of the North Indian people, I'm sure they would agree, you know, even if a girl asks for a property, for a property rights, her own parents will say, mother will say, bhai ka haq maang rahe beta. My case, it is something which is, I think, sir, these are very external factors.
Yes.
It is not an internal factor. Internal factor is that law gives us a right, and if someone is taking or depriving us of our right, you can go to the court and the judge is going to give you a decision in your favor. But the external factors are those patriarchal system, social background, and the other factors. So I think that is one reason why, if I want to do an empirical legal research on what is the implications of this Hindu Succession Amendment Act with respect to women's property rights, then I cannot do it until and unless I do up a case study or for let's say an empirical research on what has been the real situation with respect in reality. Thank you.
My comment was related to the fact that the more and more also from the field of social science who are involving in issues relating to legal rights of women.
And
instead of legal scholars, contribution to the field of feminist and legal research is not very much encouraging or inspiring. If you make a list of various topics on which PhD scholars have been registering for their PhD, even amidst women scholars, we find that the number is more relating to non-feminist issues. And in the field of feminist scholars, perhaps there is a more number of non-law scholars or social sciences scholars. Whether it is because of some deliberate outcome or whether it is because of simply default, I do not know. But there is a reality. Of course, whether the legal education system, legal education system, has not inspired the people to come up with such topics relating to feminist research. About that, you have to think, because even in my university, I am finding that. Legal scholars are opting those types of topics, not top, even if, of course, out of 10, there are about 6 persons who are women, but they are not taking topics relating to women, they are taking topics relating to some other issues, maybe alternative dispute resolution or so many other topics. Of course, we have to examine from the social reality. Of course, you are saying that it requires a case study approach and a feminist legal, social science scholars are more appropriate for that. Perhaps Shashikala Gurupur may be able to add something else.
What I suggest is that Catherine Bartlett and others, she has edited a book in which other feminist scholars have written on feminist legal methods. Feminist legal methods, just like feminism, are not isolated kind of approaches, they are hybrid methods. You must read, I have